particular Yajurveda. Sama Veda. Now remember one thing. Each Veda, whatever mantra you have, we already saw phonetics, how to do the diction pronunciation, but again those who were expert in saying only Rugveda mantra were called Hotri. They will be only talking about Rugveda. So if you have a Rugveda yajna going on, Hotris will come first. If Yajurveda people are going to do Yajurveda yajna, then you will have Advaryu. So the priest is known as Advaryu. Advaryu priest, because he knows how to pronounce Yajurveda, because that's their speciality. If it comes to Samaveda, they are altogether different people. The reason is, here you have to sing. So they are called Udgatri. So Udgatri 15-20 will come, and for that some of them used to go to forest, Aranya, and practice, because it is in a Gaya form. Most of the Samaveda is borrowed from Rugveda, but Rugveda is in a meter form, not sung. Sing it, it becomes Samaveda. But sing it means not the way you want to sing it. There are rules for singing. While in case of Atharva Veda, you find Shaunaka and Pippalada. These are two shakhas. So first is Shakha, second is Samhita, then there is Brahmana, then there is Aranyaka, then there is Upanishad. If you can see, there is Aitareya and Kausateki, two Upanishadas there in Rugveda. You have Taittiriya, Kathopanishad, Maitri Upanishad in Krishna Yajurveda, Brahadaranyaka, Shveta Shvatara, Isha Upanishad in Shukla Yajurveda, Chandogya, Kena and Talavakara in this. And then you have Mundak, Mandukya and Prashna Upanishad in Atharva Veda. So each Veda is giving different types of Upanishadas. Incidentally, these what are mentioned here are called major Upanishadas. Can you see the minor ones? Dhyana Bindu Upanishad. We recently had a seminar on this. So this Maitreya Upanishad. Then you have Shandilya Upanishad. After these Upanishadas, also it contains what is called as Griha Sutra and Dharma Sutra. Now this Dharma Sutra which you are talking, this Apasthamba, Buddhayana, Vaikhanasa, these are the Dharma Sutras which are deriving same from the Vedas, but coming in the form of Smritis, right? I'll give you example of this Vaikhanasa. Vaikhanasa is prevalent presently in and around the Shimoga district, if you know. Around Shimoga district and all you get Vaikhanasa Brahmin. They are specifically of this particular thing and they are always following Krishna Yajurveda. One such Vaikhanas person, just as a coincidence I can tell you, once one of the realized soul of this Vaikhanasa, Krishna Yajurveda, he was Jivan Mukta. In his dream, he saw a yogi and he got all the directions where to go. So he started from Shimoga and reached straight to Madras. And when he reached Madras, that was the time when the procession of Vivekananda was going on. He just looked at Vivekananda and could not stop crying. It was the same yogi that he had seen. That yogi later on met Vivekananda at his residence where he was staying. At that residence, Vivekananda asked him, "From where you are?" He said, "Sir, I am Vaikhanasa." That is that Vaikhanasa Shukla Yajurveda. Because once you adopt to a particular Veda, once you are supposed to be loyal to that. If you are a Kanva Shakha, then you are not normally supposed to meddle here and there. That there are some strict rules. So it's like a Shaiva doing Shaiva Puja. It's not that he will hate Vishnu, but he will not generally think of Vishnu. Why? Because his focus on his deity becomes so strong, then it becomes difficult for him to go to any other deity. Can we have the next slide? Here again we have given this six Vedangas, Upavedas, and then there is Shad Darshanas. We will come to that at the last because they are very important for us. Can you have the next one? Yes, sir. Pradeep, your answer is here. Can you see the Dharma Shastra books? So this one, what you see? Manusmriti, Yajnavalkya Smriti, Parashara Smriti, we already saw. They are the major sources on which so many law books have been written. See this Apastamba Sutra, you must have heard of Apastamba Sutra. Apastamba Sutra is there, Gautama Sutra is there, Shaunaka Sutra, Angirasa Sutra. These are all secondary scriptures are called law books, smritis. There are tertiary scriptures in which you have Mahapuranas. Now we have Adhara Purana. Ashtadasha Puraneshu Vyasasya Vachanadvayam Parupakaraha Punyaya Papaya Parapirana. After reading 18 Puranas, the message that you get is Parupakaraha Punyaya Papaya Parapirana. But why this Purana? Purana means what? The definition of Purana word, again I am going back where? This book, etymology. The word has Pura Iti Navaha. Pura Iti Navaha Iti Purana. It is old but new. That means that which is old but is always sounding new is called Purana. Aaj bhi Bhagavad lagta hai to lagta hai na abhi abhi shuru hua. It should be outdated actually. It will never be outdated. So that is why we have these Puranas, of which Bhagavata is the most famous. Bhagavata Purana is most famous. In which we have this Dashavatar of Bhagavana. Starting from Matsyavatar, Kurmavatar, Varaha Avatar, Narasimha Avatar, Vamana Avatar, Parashurama Avatar, Rama Avatar, Sri Krishna Avatar, Buddha Avatar, Kalki Avatar. That is how the sequence goes. So Bhagavata is all known to us, but all other Puranas also, Vishnu Purana is also very famous, Padma Purana is also famous. If you go through these Puranas, then, not that I have gone through all, but whatever little I have read, you get absolute pearls of wisdom in these Puranas. Purana is the way of finding. If you want to know what is there in Bhagavad Gita, you can see it through Purana. None of the Purana stories or the discourses between two people, you will not find that they apparently appear very simple, but they are actually pushing hard a point which is there in the Vedas. So that is the reason why Puranas are taken as Smriti literature. They are not called story books. They are not secular books at all. They are books of knowledge. That is why Purana, and these are 18 major Puranas. For example, we see we don't read Purana, right? But don't we read Navaratra Stotra, Durga Stotra? From where it comes? Brahmanda Purana. Chandi, Kali Yajna, we do. It comes from Markandeya Purana. We don't know also that it comes from that Purana, but we do it. So our life as a Hindu life says so many, all Devi Pujas have already come in all these Puranas. Then you have Upapuranas also. Purana literature itself can go into hundreds of volumes. These Puranas are available for purchase. Each Purana book is quite a lengthy book. And that if you go just by word, if the Lakshana, if it is done, philosophical compilation, if it is done, then the Purana becomes quite bigger. Can we have the next slide? Yeah. Now we have Agamas. What is an Agama? We have heard of this word Agama. Agama is a scripture that deals with mantra, tantra and yantra. These three words are very common in our religion. Mantra we are aware of. Tantra and yantra is what is confusing to us. Either we have a confusing thing, we say that ye pata nahi, or something black magic or something like that. That generally we have that concept. Agama literature is a literature that goes basically for glorifying the same Vedic philosophy in a manner where you have what is called as archa, puja, karma and karya. There are four different ways of doing each of these agamas. The first one is called as, these are pancharatra agama. This takes Balaram and Krishna as the main thing. So you will find all of them are basically about Vishnu. Pancharatra agamas are on Vishnu. While reading this, you have to be very careful because there are lot many abuses used for Shiva. If you go to the Shiva ones, there will be abuses for Vishnu. But this is called Arthavada. What is Arthavada? What you like is eulogized so much at the cost of other deities so that you remain stuck to it. Unfortunately, in medieval India, I don't know if there is any Tamil in here. This is to call Idungai and Velangai. the left-handed and the right-handed art. What was happening was Shaivas could never sit with Vaishnavas. Vaishnavas could, in fact, you know, this counter is used for doing this thing. If you have a Shaiva, he will not do this way because he will become Vishnu then. He needs to do it this way. That is how it is described. So, you know, you have, because it is exactly opposite. Tripundra that you have, it is called Tripundra. Tripundra of Shaiva is different and Vaishnava is different. So there were some people who were called Vaishnava right-handed. Idangai and Velangai. All these fights came. Hariharavada it is called. Hariharavada. But Hari and Hara is the same. That is because of Arthavada. Arthavada we need to understand. Arthavada means you, if you are doing praising somebody, put him at the top of the mountain. And if you are criticizing somebody, put him at the ditch of the water. That is called Arthavada. So these are Arthavadi. Now most of this Rudra Agama and Shaiva Agama is about only Shiva. In our Puranas also, there are three types of Purana. 18 Puranas are there, but they are grossly divided into Sattvika Purana, Rajasa Purana and Tamasa Purana. All Sattvik Puranas are for Vishnu. All Rajasa Purana are for Brahma. And all Tamasa Purana is for Shiva. So there are three types of Puranas. Similarly in Agamas, you have Panch, this is for Vishnu, the second Shaiva is for Shiva. What about Shakta? Shakta Purana, they are the ones who are devotees of Shakti. Lord, what are the powers that the Lord has? Ichha Shakti, Kriya Shakti and Jnana Shakti. All the three are Shakti. That means Shakti is the nature of Lord. Now if you take that Shakti part of it, Shakti is considered as a female part. So Shakti being female part, all the devis that you see, all they come in this Shakta. So Shakta will always be doing Chandiyaga, Kalima, Ambama, Shitalama, all devis, Durga, Durga Saptashati, all this comes basically from Shakta. And then Shakta also use Tantra. So Tantra and Mantra, two things we need to understand. Tantra is, if you are doing a puja, we all do puja. Gurudeva did puja, isn't it? Gurudeva also did puja. Maybe that Hanuman when it was brought there or whatever it is. What is the difference between our puja and Gurudeva's puja? Our puja, we remember what is to be done and we do our puja accordingly and perhaps conclude that it is done. Why? The flowers are put. I washed him also, I put him in the water and put it back there. This is called as a mechanical aspect of the puja. In the puja when we do, there is a technique of doing puja. That technique is called tantra. Tantra means what? Initiating yourself. For example, let us take Shodasha Puja. What is the Shodasha? First thing in Shodasha Puja you do? Avahanam. You come in the house. Do you keep quiet or you say please come? If a person is called please come, you are calling God. So far he hasn't come because I am starting my puja. So when avahan I am doing, I am myself saying avahanam na janami. I don't know how to invite, but I am definitely grateful to you, you will come. Now the question is, while saying this, one is mechanically saying avahanam na janami, the Krishna will go into the water. That is one way of doing it. Second is, if you really feel the way Suradas is to feel, that Krishna ki murti ko haath lagega. Even now I know of one Jeevan Mukta. You are aware of her. She stays with Krishna, Bala Krishna. When she came from Pravachana little late, she went for Darshana. Darshana didn't happen. Why? Bala Krishna was angry. It all sounds. Morning she went and she said, Kshama, beta kya ho gaya, you know, you're talking to Bala Krishna. She came here to deliver Pravachanam. When we invited her, she said, no, I have to ask Bala Krishna. She went and asked. He permitted her to go. This all sounds. Ramakrishna, what did he do? Is there anything that he did without asking the mother? Somebody came and Vivekananda came running once and he said, I saw Chatak Pakshi. Ramakrishna said, I have never seen in my life, it is only mythology. I just came. Actually, what had happened? One sparrow had come and gone like this from the Ganga. But he was very innocent, he came and said, now Ramakrishna had a problem. Jhoot to bolega nahi. Whom to ask? Went to Kali Ma. Ma, did he see Chatak? No, he came. Hey, no, it is not. This is called puja. This is called tantra, technique of puja. Tantra siddha puja is what is this in these agamas. And then what is yantra? Yantra is Ishwara Shakti. If you feel that when you take Balakrishna in front of you, what do you look in him? You look in him, same Balakrishna that was there on the lap of Yashoda Mata. In fact, you are a man or a woman, doesn't matter. You are a Yashoda Mata for Nanda Baba Baitke Pasamne Bait Jate Ho. Because now it is Balakrishna there. If this is the case, then suppose I want to have abstract thing like power of God, Shakti. Ab Shakti ka koi swarup to hai nahi. What swarup I will have? So I will make a triangle. Bandhistha swarup of Shakti. Why a triangle? Somebody who was realized, he said the Kundalini Shakti in a sarpini form, right there, muladhara, tvam muladhara sthitose nityam, muladhara chakra is that. So, aap ek chakra banao, usme wo shakti hai, aisa karo, that is called tantra, yantra. So, mantra, tantra, yantra is the part of this all agamas. Can we go back to the first one? So far, we have covered smriti, itihasa, purana, agama, and then we come to the last part, perhaps the most difficult part, darshana. So first beautiful thing about Hindu dharma is they are called darshana. What is a darshana? We all know the meaning of the word darshana. Darshan means is to bahut time ke baad aapne darshan diya, kya baat hai? You came or you showed yourself to me. We don't say you met me, we say darshan bhot. Darshan means I saw you pratyaksha. Pratyaksha anubhava. Ab ye praman jo hai, praman, shastra, isme pratyaksha jo hai, usi ko sahi mana gaya. That is called aparoksha anubhuti. So those who have had aparoksha anubhuti, the rishis, they tried to describe again based on Vedas, how Vedas can be interpreted to mean. The real surprise lies here. There are six darshanas. Six darshanas means six philosophies. Six philosophies of seeing God or mumukshatu, whatever you call it. Now, darshanas can be astik darshan or nastik darshan. Those who talk about the philosophy but don't respect Vedas is Nastik Darshana. So you have Buddhism into it, you have Jainism into it, you have Lokayat or Charvak into it. Right? Question is, if they don't respect the Vedas, why do you have them? Kam hai kya padhai itna usme aur teen ki nikal do unko. You cannot. Why? That is also intellectual speculation. Wrong, but intellectual speculation. I and you are arguing on a, we both are engineers and we are arguing on a bridge. I am less knowledgeable, you are more knowledgeable. So ultimately who will win? He will win. But he will come to know that there are two things I know which he doesn't know. So when you go to Buddhism, there are certain aspects of philosophy of Buddhism, Shunyavada, which has a larger impetus for us to understand. If you want to know about Yama Niyama of yoga, go to Jain Shastra. Mahavratam, Anuvratam, they have described in a much detail. The reason is, for that matter, once, as just as a matter of occasion, I delivered a lecture on Jainism. All the Jains were surprised. You're a Hindu, you're not a Jain. How did you know it? Because so many things from Jainism has already been absorbed into darshanas this side. That is the reason Nastik Darshan also needs to be studied. Focus, of course, is on Astik Darshan. In Astik Darshan, how the darshanas are studied? they are first of all kept in a particular sequence. You cannot just get up and start studying Vedanta or Advaita or Uttara Mimamsa. No. You start from Nyaya. First darshana that you study is in Nyaya. Why? There is a small avatarika or small sentence about Nayayika. The one who studies Nyaya is called Nayayika. They say if two Nayayiks are together, it is better to leave the village. And if you want to know this, try going into any of the, just there is something called Hetva Bhas of theirs. It either makes you mad because it is so much in depth. But the beauty of Nyaya Darshana is, Nyaya Darshan teaches you how to apply Tark, logic. So Nyaya contributes. So the first Darshana that we have is Nyaya. It was propounded by Gautama Rishi. How old it is? 6-7 centuries before Christ, that is what history says. We don't know. But again, Nyaya propounds everything on the basis of what? Veda. They say we understand Veda better. So that is their way of saying. Again, here in every darshana, you will not find anything that can be conducive to understanding, because it is pure, hardcore philosophy. All darshanas are pure philosophies. And they are pure philosophies, that's why they are difficult to understand. But each darshana does two things. The first thing is, what is this world around me? What is my role vis-a-vis this world? Is there anything called God? And is God me and this world? Me, God and this world, Jiva, Jagata and Ishwara, all the three are false or true? These questions head on are handled in these things, and each of them has given one contribution. How is this world created? Sankhyas gave the best contribution. Srushti Utpatti in the most perfect manner has been described by Sankhyas. That is why in Gita, Sankhya Tattvajnan is already there, second, third, fourth and fifth adhyaya. It's all Sankhya, right? When it comes to Nyaya, all the tarkas are coming from there. Anumana Pramana, you must have heard about Anumana. Even the word Nyaya, we all know Nyayadish, court, Nyaya. How the word has come? I mean this book. Niyate Anena Iti Nyayaha. Niyate means one that takes you towards the Mumukshatva is a Nyaya. That is how the word Nyaya has come. So you have Nyaya, then you have, next is Vaisheshika. Always Nyaya is taken together, Vaisheshika, Sankhya is taken with Yoga. Sankhya Yoga, Nyaya Vaisheshika, that is called pair. Always, why? They are very close to each other. What is the beauty of Vaisheshika? If a Vaisheshika, it was propounded by Kanada Rishi, if a Vaisheshika has written down any treatise, you cannot find anything as perfect as that for explanation of anything. Their habit is to divide and divide and divide and divide and go to the core of everything. In fact, this is particle physics we all have heard of. This is particle physics, Vaisheshika. Kanada Rishi is not the original name of Kanada. Because of Kana, Anu Kana, because he started that thing, so he is called Kanada. So Kanada Rishi has given this Vaisheshika, Nyaya Vaisheshika, they are very close. There are some differences in that. The differences, we are not interested at this moment. But there are some differences, not main, but more or less they are close to each other. So you have Nyaya Vaisheshika. What is Dharma? Yato Abhyudaya Nishreyas Tato Dharmaha. From where the definition came? Vaisheshika. Kanada Rishi. So Dharma ka abhyas karna hai, ek definition aapko Kanad ki leni padegi. Uttara Mimamsa doesn't have anything on Dharma. Our Advaita doesn't speak much about Dharma. Better it is spoken there. So, second is Vaisheshika. Sankhya and Yoga. Let's say the better, both are known to us. Sankhya, we know Sankhya Karika. Gaudapada Sankhya Karika and Gurudeva's commentary on that. If there is a feast of knowledge, if anybody wants to have, read Gurudeva's commentary on Sankhya Karika. Gaudapada himself has excelled in what he has written. He is Acharya's Paratpar Guru, Acharya's Guru's Guru, Govindagiri's Guru. But it is said that if Sankhya, Krishna Shastri was the first who wrote on Sankhya, because we don't have this original Sankhya. Sankhya is by Kapil Muni. We don't have anything available directly written by Kapil Muni. But quoted of Kapil Muni, Krishna Shastri is first. But if at all you want to study Sankhya, the book that you study is Sankhya Karika by Gaudapada. That is his biggest contribution. So Sankhya and Yoga, Yoga we all know, this is Patanjali Yoga. This is not Hatha Yoga. This is Patanjali Yoga or Raja Yoga as it is called. This was a favorite darshana of Swami Vivekananda. He himself was a Raja Yogi. Ashtada Siddhi, all we have heard about it. Anima, Garima, Lagima, Mahima. All these Siddhis are a part of Yoga, Raja Yoga. So Sankhya and Yoga. There is a transgression as you move forward. First you become intellectually competent as you come from Nyaya side. By the time you come to Yoga, you have already come to Dhyana. Chitta Shuddhi has started from that side. Thinking has started. The thinking tells you how the mind works. The mind and its working, you understand better by Sankhyas. How? Who gave you Trigunas? From where the Triguna concept came? Sankhya. Because they told us Trigunas, we know now, oh, I am Sattvic or Rajasic, I have to be Sattvic. So you learn after doing that what? Once I come to know I am Sattvic, then you come to Yoga, because Yoga is nothing else but fusion. You have to meditate. After you meditate, Purva Mimamsa, Uttar Mimamsa, Purva Mimamsa, both have a common word called Mimamsa. What is Mimamsa? Mimamsa is analysis of, intellectual analysis of anything that is abstract is Mimamsa. Probing in English as we call it. Purva Mimamsa is by Jaimini Shastra, Jaimini Rishi. And then of course on that, Kumaril Bhatta, you must have heard of in Shankaracharya's time, the one who died on the bed of rice husk simply because he lost. Some people had put a bet on him that are Vedas infallible. He said, if I believe in Vedas, nothing will happen to me. So somebody said, will you jump from the mountain? He said, yes. And then while jumping, he said, if Vedas are infallible, are not infallible, nothing will happen to me. Unfortunately, when he died, he had a fracture. When he fell down, he had a fracture. So these people came and said that, look, you had a fracture. He said, no. I said, if, I shouldn't have said that. If Vedas are infallible. I said, if, that's why this fractured. But I agree with you. And then what did he do? The punishment was simple. The rice husk was put on the fire. Rice husk slowly burns. So he slipped on that. And by the time he has into advanced stage of burning, for Vada Vivada, Shankaracharya reached there. And he said, I have come for Vada. He said, you have come for Vada, but I am almost done now. I can't really do. He said, what should I do then? He said, I have a Shishya of mine called Mandan Mishra. Go and fight with him. That is how he went to Mandan Mishra. This Kumaril Bhatta is from Purva Mimamsa. So we have Shabara Muni, Kumaril Bhatta called Kumar Vartika, and Jaimini Rishi about Purva Mimamsa. What do? They say you can get moksha by only doing rituals and yajnas. And it is not just a boasting about it. The reason being, we have all seen types of karmas. Sakama karma, nishkam karma, then prayashit karma. All this karma, whatever we have seen, is all because of Purva Mimamsa. So all karma kanda, 99% of our life is in karma. Because we are not sannyasis, we are grahastha. So that means in the karma that I am doing as a family man, what should exactly I be doing so that karma itself becomes my salvation? That is Purva Mimamsa. And then after Purva Mimamsa, we have the last darshan called Uttara Mimamsa. Uttara Mimamsa is also called Advaita. Uttara Mimamsa is called Advaita, though it should not be called as that. Why? In Uttara Mimamsa, there are many other vadas also. Vishishta Advaita, Kevala Advaita, Bheda Bheda, Darshanam, all these come from Uttara Mimamsa. Uttara Mimamsa is written by the Rishi Badrayana, that is Vyasa. all that we are studying in Upanishads and Bhagavad Gita is Uttarmimamsa. This is a short description of what the Hindu literature or scriptures are all about. We haven't gone into detail of anything. This is just to show the arrangement how it is there. Of this, for a man, unless from childhood he is devoted, it is impossible. So the what is the thing that we should be keeping in our mind? In our mind, what we should be doing is prasthana trayam, as told by our elders and acharyas. We should focus on Upanishad, Brahma Sutra, and Bhagavad Gita. Unfortunately, since we have started with Bhagavad Gita, and since we are lucky that Gurudev has made it simple for us, while reading Gita, every now and then, as Gita is moving forward, it is better to take at least one Upanishad. And as we do in our school studies, the smallest book we take first. So smallest Upanishad, meaning Keno Upanishad or Prashno Upanishad or even Isho Upanishad for that matter, take one mantra and start doing it. Upanishads will start opening up for us. Luckily, Swamiji has written on all the Upanishads. He has written on all the Upanishads. So that commentary is available. After you feel that at a certain level you have started feeling that I am slightly comfortable with Sanskrit as well as I am understanding the science of this particular metaphysics, at that point of time then you can dare to enter into Brahma Sutra. So that is the way we study, and in these three itself are enough for remaining balance period of our life, because the rest for us it is not possible. By chance, if we are able to get Valmiki Ramayana Prata or Mahabharata Prata, this as a change of subject could be a good addition. Purana also can be a good addition for us. Even if we don't remember all the characters of these Puranas, etc., but the stories, and if we are able to put that in context with the two mantras that we are studying in our Bhagavad Gita, that way the study can move forward. All I feel is that since we all are Hindus, we are all blessed by Gurudeva, we all know Gurudeva, we all know Lord Krishna, it is not far that one day it will dawn upon us. One choice is to study all, or one choice is to study one and get all. Gurudeva opted for the second one. He studied one and got all. Tasmin bhagavo vidnyate sarvam idam vidnyato bhavati. That is Brahmajnana. So if you do our sadhana and the grasp of all these things automatically keeps on increasing as our chitta shuddhi goes up, as our meditative powers go up, concentration goes up, then automatically sattvikta will compel us to study all this. You feel like studying more and more. It comes. If it is not coming, that means rajasikta is more. If it is not at all coming, tamasikta is more. Then we have to work on our gunas.